Moving on to the very interesting and important topic of the chapter, this topic itself, you know, this elimination of this excretory products, okay, that is urine formation. How the urine is going to form in our body? The urine formation is the one which includes the three processes: glomerular filtration, reabsorption, and the secretion. The glomerular filtration, as I also referred it as a ultrafiltration, I justify the statement after once we step into the concept why it's also referred as the ultrafiltration. First, let me justify what's the glomerular filtration is. As we discussed several times, I raised the point saying that blood is brought to the kidneys by the renal artery in order to filter, in order to eliminate the waste, renal artery. And this is branched as afferent arteriole, is called as the one which is bringing the blood. Here it is, the afferent arteriole bringing the blood. Here it is. And this brings the blood with a pressure, some hydrostatic pressure, because the filtration just doesn't happen apne aap. It needs some pressure to get filtered. And that filtration pressure is by the hydrostatic pressure in the afferent arteriole. What's this hydrostatic pressure? The pressure exerted in the blood vessels due to the pumping of the heart. You know, heart is a pumping organ. पिछले सेशन में उन्हें आपने सीखे थे. सो इस आई मीन हियर इफ यू टॉक अबाउट व्हाट इज दिस हाइड्रोस्टैटिक प्रेशर, द प्रेशर एक्सर्टेड इन द ब्लड वेसल्स ड्यू टू द फिल्ट्रेशन, ड्यू टू द पंपिंग ऑफ हार्ट. हार्ट इज अ पंपिंग ऑर्गन. सो एज इट ब्रॉट द ब्लड टू द केस ऑफ ग्लोमेरुलस, एज द फिल्ट्रेशन इज हैपनिंग थ्रू द ग्लोमेरुलस इज कॉल्ड एज ग्लोमेरुलर फिल्ट्रेशन. And you are observing very clearly here, guys, the afferent arteriole is the one which brings, an efferent arteriole which carry away here. And this one is with a wider lumen, whereas efferent arteriole with a narrow lumen. It's to be the point to be noted here, though its specification is not there anywhere, but is important, you can consider to be. I mean, it's to be considered actually. So here, the afferent arteriole brings the blood here, and the filtration happens through what? And how much is blood is going to be filtered? Around 1100 to 1200 ml of blood per minute is going to be filtered by the kidneys. Means if you consider both the kidneys, the amount of blood filtered per minute is 1100 to 1200 ml. This is equal to how much? It is equal to 1 by 5th the volume of the cardiac output, guys. You know what is cardiac output? The volume of the blood pumped out by each ventricle per 1 minute is called as cardiac output. Already you learned this in the body fluids and circulation chapter. So, the amount of blood brought to the kidneys for the purpose of filtration, I mean this filtration is nothing but the 1 by 5th the volume of the cardiac output, guys, here. And how is going to be filtered? What is that membrane? The filtration membrane is of three layers is important. What is this three layers? So the endothelium of glomerulus, you know, glomerulus is a blood vessel, is a capillaries, network of capillaries lined with a simple squamous epithelium called as endothelium. I'm several times repeating so that it should imprint in your brain. Okay, so endothelium of the blood vessels and the basement membrane and the Bowman's capsule. As we discussed, as I said priorly, that Bowman's capsule is lined with the foot-shaped cells called as podocytes. There are foot-shaped cells, here it is, foot-like cells, leaving the space, you know, called as pedicels. They are called as pedicels. In these pedicels, if you talk about the case of here, the pedicels, in this, the glomerular blood capillaries are intricately present. I am showing here so that you can understand here. So, in the pedicels of the podocytes of the Bowman's capsule of the simple squamous epithelium is important point here. Simple squamous epithelium with podocytes in Bowman's capsule is lined with. And here as it leaving the space called as pedicels, in this the blood vessels, glomerular blood vessels will intricately present. They are very closely present in a such a way they will form a filtration membrane with the three layers. So here Bowman's capsules podocytes, simple squamous epithelium of podocytes, the endothelium of glomerulus, and the basement substance of both together called as a filtration membrane. How many layers filtration membrane? 3 layers. Apne pade ate. I mean, like previously you learned that. So fast me. कुछ हुआ तो गलत मत समझिए. ओके सो हियर आपने ऑलरेडी कम अक्रॉस विद द केस ऑफ दिस ब्रीथिंग एंड एक्सचेंज ऑफ गैसेस. हियर इट इज इन दैट आल्सो द फिल्ट्रेशन आई मीन द डिफ्यूजन मेम्ब्रेन इज ऑफ 3 लेयर्स. हियर आल्सो फिल्ट्रेशन मेम्ब्रेन ऑफ 3 लेयर्स. ओके इट गेट्स फिल्टर्ड. ओके सो द पोडोसाइट्स ऑफ बाउमेन्स कैप्सूल एंड दिस एंडोथेलियम एंड द बेसमेंट सब्सटेंस प्रेजेंट इन बिटवीन दीज टू. सो इट गेट्स फिल्टर्ड हियर लाइक दिस. You'll get the doubt what it's going to be filtered. Blood, all the composition of the plasma of the blood's plasma is going to be filtered except the plasma proteins. You know, plasma contains the how much percentage of water and how much percent of the solutes and all we discussed. Except the plasma proteins of 6 to 8% of the plasma proteins, except that entire plasma gets filtered. As the filtration is happening in that minute level, in that ultra level, leaving except the plasma proteins, remaining all thing is filtering, is called as ultra filtration. Ultra, very microscopic, very minute level is happening. Hence is called as ultra filtration. I hope I justified the statement. Glomerular filtration, because the blood is getting filtered through glomerulus. Ultra filtration, the blood, which components are filtering? Entire components of the plasma except the plasma proteins, hence is called as ultrafiltration. I hope you understood here. And moving on to the glomerular filtration rate, GFR. What is this glomerular filtration rate? The volume of the filtrate is going to be filtered by the kidneys in 1 minute. How much filtrate is going to be filtered, whatever this filter, the filtrate will be going to be formed here, with which we'll call it as a renal fluid. And this renal fluid or primary urine, how much volume of the filtrate formed by the both the kidneys in 1 minute is called as glomerular filtration rate, is referred as GFR. In a healthy person, the GFR is around 125 ml per minute. If you calculate in this way, the amount of volume of renal fluid or the urine in terms, the primary urine, is 180 liters per day. Are you going to excrete 180 liters per day? It's a very big joke. Okay, so you can't excrete. If you want to excrete 180 liters per day, you will be always a care of washrooms, your favorite rooms. No. The healthy person eliminates only 1 to 1.5 liters per day. Though the volume differs. If it is winter, the volume increases. If you intake water is more, the volume increases. And here, so the volume, though it won't exceed like 180 liters. So, by this we come to know major part of this renal fluid gets reabsorbed back into the body. Only out of 180, if this proportionately, if you talk about the formation is 180 liters per day, but 99% gets reabsorbed back. That's called as in the second process called as reabsorption. We'll call it a selective reabsorption. That we'll discuss in the case of the next coming process. Let me finish off this. How it is going to be regulated in a such a way? The kidneys are intricately, they have the mechanism in order to regulate all these things. That is called as by the juxtaglomerular apparatus, JGA. What is this juxtaglomerular apparatus? I showed you very clearly in the figure. This is AA, meaning afferent arteriole. Rarely it forms with efferent arteriole. Mainly it forms with afferent arteriole. Afferent arteriole, when it come in contact with the case of the DCT, that is distal convoluted tubule, the point where the both will meet, come in contact with each other. And here we can see that the smooth muscles present in the blood vessel, that is afferent arteriole, they'll get modified there, called as JG cells, juxtaglomerular cells. And the DCT, the point at the contact of these both, the DCT, the distal convoluted tubule, as I said previously, in this called as a nothing but the cuboidal epithelium lining the DCT. The cuboidal epithelium lining the DCT, in that at contact point, some of the cells are grouped there, hence called as macula densa. So dense mass of cells are seen there. So the macula densa and the JG cells of afferent arteriole, macula densa of DCT, though it's not given in your NCRT, but it's important, just go ahead. Though we are confining ourselves, so based on the content, there is a probability of the questions. That's why I'm deviating somewhere, whichever required. So here, JG cells, the juxtaglomerular cells of afferent arteriole, and the macula densa of the DCT together, called as JGA, juxtaglomerular apparatus. This juxtaglomerular apparatus will become activated whenever the glomerular filtration rate becomes low. If glomerular filter, if glomerular flow becomes less, I mean the blood bringing to the nephron become less, filtration rate also become less. If filtration rate is less, obviously what happens means the JGA becomes activated and it start secreting the enzyme called as a renin. And what it will do, we'll discuss later. By this, it is going to regulate the glomerular filtration rate. And let's talk about the next process, that is reabsorption. As we mentioned in the urine formation, the three processes. The first process, we finish the glomerular filtration or ultrafiltration. The very next process left over is the reabsorption and the secretion. Let's discuss why the reabsorption is required. That too, it's called a selective reabsorption. Only the selective components are going to be reabsorbed back, because as we discussed, the glomerular filtration rate in a healthy person is 125 ml per minute. Mane, it is 180 liters per day. But the person won't discharge 180 liters per day. Only 1 to 1.5 liter. Means, though it varies according to the seasons, the output, I mean urine excretion based on the intake of water. But as of sure that 99% of the renal fluid is going to be reabsorbed back. And here the very second event, we are saying that selective reabsorption. Whichever the components are required, they are going to be selectively reabsorbed back. As I started, I hope you are remembering that the point, the lesson I started with. Homeostasis is the ever task of an organism. Means they need to maintain the fluid and the ionic balance. It's to be ever time process. As we discuss in that way here, I mean to mention that. So, whichever the components, how much the components of the volume of that ionic and fluid is there, is required, till that it is going to be maintained. If it is excess, if it is an additional amount than the required, it will be eliminated back. That's why we are using the word selective reabsorption. You are not supposed to call it as absorption. It is reabsorption. We use the word absorption in the human digestive system. But here it is reabsorption. Again, it reabsorbing back based on the requirements of the body in order to maintain the osmoregulation, guys. I hope though you feel like why it's a lengthy, the concept. If you develop the concept, I mean, if you are going to grasp it easily in this chapter, it become easy, or else it is difficult, guys. Every time the same dialogue, so you feel, but it's a mandatory to say. So here, as I'm saying, is a selective reabsorption. Here it is. And another one is secretion, tubular secretion. Tubular secretion, you'll get the doubt. Actually, what it means, the secretion? If you see this picture, I'm showing this. This Bowman's capsule, I mean Malpighian body, the PCT and the DCT is present in the cortex region. The Henle's loop and the collecting duct is present in the medullary region. You are observing it very clearly. Means that here, you are also observing in this figure, some arrows are put outward and some arrows into the renal tubule. The one which are focusing to the outside, it means to say that it is a reabsorption. I mean, whatever the components needed, they are going to be reabsorbed, and that enters into the extracellular fluid present in between the nephrons of the kidney, and from that it enters into the blood, and through the blood it reaches back to the case of the organism. Hope you understood this. Whereas the arrows into the renal tubule, it means that secretion. Why they need secretion? Some are reabsorbed and some are secreted in order to maintain the osmolarity gradient. In this picture, you are observing very clearly that the H plus ions, ammonia ions and K plus ions are secreting into the tubule. It is in order to maintain the ionic and the pH balance. Let's move on to the where, in which part of the tubule, as we said, tubular reabsorption, that is selective reabsorption. In which part, what happens? Let's see, guys. PCT, the proximal convoluted tubule, as I mentioned earlier, is lined with a simple cuboidal epithelium with brush borders, which increases the area of absorption. Around 70 to 80% of the water here, it gets reabsorbed. Water and electrolytes gets reabsorbed. Here it is. And you are observing bicarbonate reabsorbed, water, NaCl and the nutrients. Almost, as we said, during ultrafiltration, all the components of the plasma are filtered into the Bowman's capsule except the plasma proteins. So, in that nutrients are present, vitamins are present, some essential components are present. Based on the threshold levels required in our body, almost we can say that the nutrients all, almost it gets reabsorbed in PCT itself, guys. Here, what makes that much amount, that percentage of water to leave, electrolytes to leave? Some of the substances are reabsorbed by active process. You know pretty well, active money, it requires energy. Energy expenditure is required for that process. That will refer as an active process, guys. So here, I mean to say that Na, that is sodium, is reabsorbed actively. If sodium reabsorbs, chlorine also reabsorbs. Chlorine gets reabsorbed by passive. Sodium by active, chlorine by passive. And water, if these solutes go out, water cannot stay inside. Water will say that, let's wait, guys, I'll come. I won't be alone here. Just for that, you can take it easy way. I'm going this saying, if Na goes by active process, chlorine moves by the way, reabsorbing by passive process, and water obviously by osmosis. You know, the osmosis is a process where water leaves. Here, as water is, reabsorption is not regulated here. It's not conditioned. Unconditional water, no conditions here it is. Unconditional, unregulatory water reabsorption takes place here. So we can use also the word saying here called as a obligatory water reabsorption, compulsory, obligation it is. If someone says that why you did like that, it's obligation, guys, what can I do? Hona pada, I mean karna pada. Isiliye we'll say that word obligatory here, obligation here, because as solutes left, obviously, the obligation happened for the water to leave the tubule. Here it is. Obligatory or mandatory, or we can say that here it is unconditional and unregulated water. It's not regulated by anyone here, the hormone and all. And you're also observing that reabsorption of the potassium and here secretion of the H plus ions and ammonia. Potassium also major percent gets reabsorbed here, but some content is somewhat here overlapping to the picture and to the content, but here, but majority of the potassium gets reabsorbed here it is. And one which is secreted is H plus ions and ammonia is going to be secreted. If arrow moves into the tubule, secretion, it is reabsorption, that is PCT. Moving on to the Henle's loop, or we can call it as a loop of Henle. You know, loop of Henle have two limbs, descending limb and ascending limb. As I mentioned here, this is a thin segment and it is a thick segment. Thin segment and the descending limb is lined by simple squamous epithelium. Thick segment is lined by the simple cuboidal epithelium, guys, here. And the loop of Henle, as I mentioned earlier, is a characteristic feature of nephron of mammalian nephrons here. And though reabsorption rate here, it is minimum. Because though reabsorption rate is minimum, here it is, but it play a major role in maintaining the higher osmolarity gradient. Here, it may, you'll better understood by the next topic, here it is. After followed by this, you'll better understand this word, this terminology. I'll justify each and everything, nothing to worry. No worries. So here, the descending, I mean, though in loop of Henle or Henle's loop, the rate of reabsorption is minimum, but it plays a major role in making that hypertonic, more concentration comparative to the medullary fluid, because as is present in the medullary region, the fluid over here is called as a medullary fluid. Here is cortical fluid. And here in PCT, after moving to the Henle's loop here, in one word PCT, we can conclude that it is helpful in maintaining the pH and ionic balance. How it is maintaining the pH? By secreting H plus ions. How it is maintaining the ionic balance? In reabsorbing some like NaCl bicarbonates and secreting the NH3 ammonia. And descending limb is permeable to water but impermeable to electrolytes. Around like 15% of water gets reabsorbed, here it is, but it is permeable to water but impermeable to electrolytes. I hope you understood and point to be noted. Ascending limb of loop of Henle. It is the only part of nephron where it is impermeable to water but permeable to electrolytes. It's permitting the electrolytes like NaCl to leave, but not the water. It is impermeable to electrolyte, it is impermeable to water. And you are observing in this, NaCl is reabsorbed here. This part I'll tell you later about the urea. Moving on to the case of the DCT, distal convoluted tubule, which is also lined by the simple cuboidal epithelium. Here around some like 9% of the water gets reabsorbed here, but still here the reabsorption of water and the salts is regulated by the two hormones here, by name ADH, and the next one is here, the water reabsorption is by the case of ADH, I am writing here, that is antidiuretic hormone. NaCl by the hormone called as aldosterone, guys. It is a salt retaining hormone and this is a water retaining hormone. With the help of this ADH and aldosterone, water and the salts is reabsorbed. But here it's not mandatory, it depends upon the condition, here it is. If body requires, the ADH will make the water to reabsorb back. For example, you still need water, the body volume, I mean still water composition is required after PCT reabsorption also. Here the leftover water gets reabsorbed. Means here is a regulatory, water reabsorption is regulated by the hormone. Which hormone? ADH, antidiuretic hormone, or is otherwise called as vasopressin. You'll better understood in the endocrine system, chemical control and coordination chapter. But as of now, I would like to say here it is, ADH is a hormone of hypothalamus which helpful for the reabsorption of water. Moving on to the aldosterone. Aldosterone is a salt retaining hormone. So here, water and the salt reabsorption is conditional. It depends upon the threshold levels of your body requirement. So it is optional. Whether required, reabsorbs. Not required, no reabsorption. So we can say it's a facultative, optional. Here I said obligatory, mandatory. Here it is facultative, based on the requirement. Hope you understood. Here, NaCl gets reabsorbed, water, bicarbonates and K plus ions and H plus ions and ammonia is secreted. So in one word, I would like to conclude that DCT is the part of nephron which controls the pH, I mean ionic balance, especially here, ionic balance, at the same time sodium potassium balance. I'll use the word sodium potassium balance by the DCT. The last is the collecting duct here, guys. The collecting duct also here, the major parts, water percentage gets reabsorbed, like around 10% of water gets reabsorbed here. And even you are observing here in this collecting duct, K plus and H plus ions are secreting. So I can say that it is involved in the maintenance of pH and ionic balance. If H plus ions are secreting, means in order to maintain the pH balance. Hydrogen ion concentration, you know well. At the same time, it's here you are observing the urea is reabsorbed. Though we are ureotelic animals, our chief nitrogenous waste is urea. We are supposed to excrete the urea out. But some amount of urea gets reabsorbed. It is based on our threshold levels in order to maintain the osmolarity gradient. Some amount of urea is stored in our body fluids in order to maintain the osmolarity gradients. I mean the solutes of this concentration of the solutes. So urea, which is reabsorbed from collecting duct, is secreted into the ascending limb of loop of Henle. Hope you understood this well. Here it is. So this is about the collecting duct part. So this is urine formation. Both I discussed glomerular filtration. I finished off priorly with the diagrammatic pictures and all. What made to filter? What filtered? How much filtered? That we discussed. Here, which is selectively reabsorbed and what is the secretion happened also we discussed. Let's move on to the next.